Ms. Colger, I knew you'd be here tonight. This is my cookie. This is my daughter.
Free cookies.
Yeah, I saved your seat.
I'm getting there.
Yeah, take your time.
Good evening. How are you today? You grab some refreshments, coffee and water up here. That little demographic sheet at the top, if you'll fill that out at your leisure, we'll come back and grab it. Thank you.
Thank you.
We have refreshments for you at your leisure. Just help yourself, okay?
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Where to?
Hello?
No, I remember you well. We got refreshments for you. Help yourself. Coffee, water.
And they came. Yes.
Hello.
Email.
Well, welcome to the end of the It's just me.
Yeah,
I'll take that one.
Your nasty.
Anything else come up? Water? You? No, I'm not.
It's good.
This whole row wants something.
Oh, Terry, so you were serving them, huh?
Well, she's very happy.
I know.
And they really won't do anything.
Evening, how are you?
She's older.
We got refreshments available. You're welcome.
And they can't do anything.
Have a seat.
Oh, sorry, sorry, Dad. How are you doing? Okay? What's really nice is.
Thank you. If you all would, while we're waiting to begin, this little demographic sheet that's on the notebook you received, if you would fill that out for us, we can come by and grab that for you, we would greatly appreciate it. Feel free to get some refreshments, water, and coffee at your leisure, let us know if we can be any assistance to you. Thank you.
12.
You think he gets nervous? This is like a short class.
This is considered a class when they ask you. Where you sit? Well, good evening, everyone, how are you doing? I just want to welcome you to Duke Spine Institute. Dr. Patel will be doing a presentation today on the PRP stem cell therapy. And Dr. Patel has 5 board certifications, only one in 30,000 physicians in the nation actually are quintuple board certified. Dr. Patel has board certifications in pain medicine, physiatry, sports medicine, interventional pain management, and electrodiagnostic medicine. If you want, Dr. Patel, if you want to come over and start your presentation, be glad to start. You got the door. Good evening.
Here we are trying to learn something about, something called regenerative medicine. I'm not sure how many people have heard that term. Regenerative medicine, biologics, it's a different name. So usually in the meeting, we usually say if any ties with the companies or anything, so I don't have anything to disclose. So regenerative medicine, it broadly deals with using biologic materials or biologics to stimulate the body's own repair mechanisms to heal previously irreparable tissues or organs. So regenerative medicine is a concept that refers to inducing and stimulating healing in your musculoskeletal medicine. That's what we're going to talk about today. There are lots of other applications, but as we the spine center and we deal with the musculoskeletal here, I'll be talking about that, how to apply to the musculoskeletal. Stem cells hold the promise of treatment and cures for more than 70 major diseases that affect millions of the people. So you are alive, you innate, you have regenerative capacity. Every second, 15 million blood cells expire are replaced in the human body without you knowing. So body does regenerate, the tissues, cells, you name it. Regenerative medicine, this combination is called biologics. Two components mainly filtered in its plasma, and the stem cell-based therapy. So first we're going to look into platelet-rich plasma. What is it? So platelet-rich plasma, or also known as PRP, contains supraphysiological concentration of the platelets. So your platelets could be 4 to 8 times of your normal platelets. So when you have the blood test done, you see all those numbers, white blood cells, red blood cells count, platelet counts. So platelet-rich plasma contains 4 to 8 times of the platelets in that solution. So if you look in the normal, if you take your blood and you just put it in the slide and look in the microscope, you see very few platelets here. When we do the platelet-rich plasma of your own blood and look in the microscope, you can see how many platelets are there. Lots of platelets. In the normal blood, you can have 94% of the red blood cells, 1% of the, or less than 1% of the white blood cells, about 6% of platelets. The platelet-rich plasma, it jumps to the big portion. 94% becomes platelets. A very small amount of the red blood cells. What are the platelets? Platelets are one of the very small, dish-shaped, small components of blood cells, like white blood cells and red blood cells. They derive from the bone marrow. They synthesize lots of biological active proteins, growth factors, that promotes the tissue regeneration. The platelets are also helps or the responsible for the blood clot formation too. Average lifespan for the platelets is 5 to 9 days. So every 5 to 9 days, your platelets are constantly getting replaced, getting formed in the bone marrow, comes in the blood system, gets destroyed by the spleen, new platelets come. So that's a constant process going in the body. The DTA contains 3 types of granules and 1100 types of proteins. It's hard to list everything here, but you can see 1100 types of proteins. Those are responsible for lots of growth factors that helps for the regeneration. So growth factors derive from the platelets. What they do? They stimulate the cell replication of the tissue. Promotes the angiogenesis, which helps to promote the blood vessel, new blood vessel formation. When you have injury, when you have scarring, you don't have blood supply there. The blood supply is bad. So you to heal the tissue, the first thing needs to be done is to form the new blood vessels so you can have the blood flow there. Blood is the only way you can really get the nutrients to the tissues to heal it or to regenerate or to get rid of the scar. It promotes the tissue granulation formation, promotes growth of the extracellular matrix, all those help to get rid of the scarring or the injury and form the new tissue. They also have antibacterial effects. So when you inject platelet-rich plasma in any tissue, they also work as antibacterial and take care of, helps with the reducing or getting of the, some infection in that area too. So healing process may result in one of the following outcomes. So if you have an injury, and the injury is healing, it can go in the 3 directions. One is scar formation. Scar formation is a non-functional tissue. There is no use. It's dead tissue. Reparation of partially functional tissue means that it just gets repairing just partially, not fully. So it's not working as normal as possible. And then the normal tissue formation means fully functional tissue. Platelets are involved in many phases of tissue healing, and they are actually critical in repair and regeneration. So if you add supernatural layers of platelets to platelet-rich plasma, you put lots of platelets that's concentrated in a small volume of the fluid, it's going to really help to kickstart the regeneration process. So how we prepare the platelets? We draw the blood, all right? We spin it a couple of times, and what we do is we do the first spin separates platelets, or first spin separates plasma and the red blood cells. And in between there, there is something called buffy coat that contains lots of platelets. So after the first spin, we basically take these out, put in a different syringe, and then re-spin again. And we get rid of these red blood cells. We don't need red blood cells. The red blood cells can harm the tissues if we inject in the high amount. Once the platelet-rich plasma is, we get PRP from your own blood. Basically, we do the injection in the tissue or the structure we need, the joint, spine, the tendons. The most important thing is when you have the platelet-rich plasma injection or stem cell-based therapy, the guidance is very important. You cannot do the blind injection. You have to have certain kind of guidance to do that injection. Ultrasound guidance or photo guidance. Some people do the CAT scan guidance. Many people does the blind injection. Not really recommended because you don't know where you're going. I can put the needle blindly without any guidance and I'm not in the tissue I want to inject. If you don't inject where it's needed, inject it, it's not going to work. This works very locally. This is not like systemic effect, like steroid head. It has to be injected. So if you're doing the knee joint injection, it has to be done under fluoroscope or ultrasound guidance, you know, making sure your needle keeps it definitely inside the joint. If you're injecting in your rotator cuff muscles or the tendons, you use ultrasound guidance, make sure your needle tip is in the rotator cuff muscle and not outside. Stem cells. So adult, as we say, all the blood cells comes from the bone marrow. So adult bone marrow has two kinds of stem cells. One called hematopoietic stem cells, or HSC. From that, all the blood cells forms from white blood count, red blood cells, platelets, everything comes from HSC. The second category is MSC, called mesenchymal stem cells. These are the stem cells we're talking about. That's the stem cell-based therapy. This is the what you want to inject in the tissue for the regeneration. Injecting these does nothing. It's just waste of the injection. So you have to get these cells to get the regeneration. So mesenchymal stem cells, it's called MSCs. So they are actually in a lot of structures in your body. They are everywhere. Okay, but obviously you cannot get those from every structure listed here. It has to be absorbed or taken out from certain structures, and then we'll go over that later. So currently, mesenchymal stem cells, not just the stem cells, you have to say MSCs. That's the sentinels of injury and as management of the host's innate regenerative capacity. There's something called pericytes. These are the cells that's lined up outside of your blood vessels, like a parasite, but they are not really parasites. These are the cells who are responsible for the repair of the tissues, or at least kickstarts. And that the mesenchymal stem cells are the pericytes. They are like covered like this, everywhere in your body. So if you look under a microscope, you can see this. This is the real picture. So they cover, it's like, you know, clinging everywhere in your tissues. So anytime there is an injury, it gets activated. You see more and more. You can see all those. So this is very high-speed microscope. So proposed sequence, what happens? When the injury happens, it activates the pericytes or near the blood vessels in the tissues and other tissues. They activate the mesenchymal stem cells. The mesenchymal stem cell gets activated, and then it's convert in the regenerative mesenchymal stem cells. Conversion means mesenchymal stem cells are very multipotent cells, means they differentiate in the cells of the tissues they are in or that you inject in. So if you inject them into the tendon, they will differentiate and make the more tendon cells or the muscle cells. If you inject them in the bone, they will differentiate and make more bone cells. So it depends which environment they are, they're gonna, you know, differentiate or get, they produce or reproduce those kind of cells. That's why it's called, they are more multipotent. Red blood cells can multiply into red blood cells. Platelets can multiply into platelets. Mesenchymal stem cells are gonna get multiplied in the tissues you want. What tissues you want, they will multiply in those cells. So same thing, the injury response is something called trophic. All these are the stagings, and that leads to the regeneration. And the stems are responsible to kickstart and this whole cascade of the healing. So nowadays, we don't call them mesenchymal stem cell, we call medicinal signaling cell. The injury-specific drugstore. Means wherever the injury happens, the mesenchymal stem cell starts healing that tissue. So mesenchymal stem cell dock at the sites of broken or inflamed blood vessels. Anytime you have an injury, you always have the blood vessel broken. And that's where the pericytes I showed before on the blood vessel, they get activated and they convert into the mesenchymal stem cells. And they start with the regeneration. So it's a whole different, whole long process of the healing. In pain management, mesenchymal stem cells are effective in the central and peripheral nervous system, reducing the inflammation and enhancing the regenerative activity. There are numerous publications, articles coming out every day that proves this thing. So this is a simple, it's a complex, but the pericytes, as we showed before, gets activated to activate the mesenchymal stem cells. Mesenchymal stem cells, and then it can basically get in the cell formation whatever the tissues you want, bone, cartilage, muscle, marrow, tendon, adipose tissue, connective tissue. Whatever the tissue you want to form, you inject those mesenchymal stem cells. As you say, this is not the end, it is not even the beginning of the end, but it is the, perhaps the end of the beginning. So it's constantly developing, evolving field. Every day the things changes. You know, I put the articles, and next day we have another 10 articles showing more and more success. So the back to the future. Again, stem cells help create new cells in existing healthy tissues and also help repair tissues in those structures that are injured or damaged. There are basically three kinds of the stem cells. Embryonic stem cells, that's from the embryo. Induced pluripotent stem cells and adult stem cells, also known as the mesenchymal stem cells. We don't use embryonic stem cells. You know, it's not, you cannot use it in the United States anyway, but embryonic stem cells are known to cause cancer. So if embryonic stem cells get injected, they can form the cancer. Induced pluripotent stem cells, basically you take out the stem cells and then you have to grow in the lab. You can get your stem cells, take in the lab and multiply them, but it's not allowed in the United States. In the Europe, yes. So usually we use the adult stem cells called mesenchymal stem cells. So mesenchymal stem cells, there's a couple of places you can harvest them. One is from the bone. The most commonly we harvest from your hip bone, something called iliac crest. This is the back of your hip bone here. This is your sacrum, this is a coccyx, and this is whole pelvic. So this is pelvic bone. Under the x-ray or the fluoroscope, these are the sites. So under the x-ray guidance, we basically put the needle in your iliac crest area in the bone marrow. Every bone has the bone marrow in the center, the cavity. And that's where the bone marrow is located, and that's where all the cells get formed. So basically you put the needle there and you basically harvest or get the bone marrow aspirated out. It's something called bone marrow aspirate concentrate. There are different techniques there. It seems painful, but it's not really that painful. The way we do it is easier than the bone marrow biopsy. Somehow people say bone marrow biopsy is very painful, and this harvesting is almost same as bone marrow biopsy, which is a different needle. So once you aspirate the blood or the bone marrow aspirate, when you picture-wise, it looks like this when you get from the bone marrow. It's called bone marrow aspirate concentrate because you're taking out from the bone marrow. So once you aspirate, one technique is the same as the platelet-rich plasma. You centrifuge them and then get the concentrated bone marrow cells, and then you can inject them. Other place, common place to get the stem cells is the fat, adipose tissue. Adipose tissue is very, very rich in the mesenchymal stem cells compared to bone marrow. So when you look at adipose, these are all small things. These are the mesenchymal stem cells. The problem is you can see how they are so like intermingled. It's very hard to separate them compared to the bone marrow. So usually the harvesting is from the flank areas where you have the adipose tissues or fat. You collect, basically aspirate the fat using special equipment. And then there is a couple of ways to get the mesenchymal stem cell rich fluid. You cannot inject the fat itself, whole fat, you know, in the joints or the disc or anything. You have to get that, you know, concentrated liquid to inject. So there's a different method called adipose washing, gravity sedimentations. So this is the tissue or the fat with the mesenchymal stems. This is the oil that you get rid of it. Or you can centrifuge it. Or physical separation. Again, this is not one you want to inject. This is you need to discard because there's lots of oils, lipids. You don't need that. That's really harm to the tissue. So you take that out. So adipose tissue stem cells, the best way to get the concentrated stem cells from the fat is something called stromal vascular fraction. Stromal vascular fraction is a very thin liquid that contains lots of stem cells. The problem is to get the stromal vascular fraction, you have to digest the fat. So whatever the fat you take it out from the body, using enzymes or something, you have to digest to really separate it. In the United States, you cannot do that. FDA has the rule that you cannot have more than minimal manipulation of the mesenchymal stem cells. And the reason you cannot do that is when you have more manipulation than minimal, those stem cells can mutate. If you mutate, they can cause cancer. So they have to be very careful. Some company do that under investigation something. Recently FDA has actually sent them the notices not to do that anymore because it's illegal. So again, in our practice, we mainly use bone marrow. So I harvest the bone marrow aspirate from your bone marrow in the inject. The needle I use specifically, it's very special needle where when I do the aspiration, I usually get concentrated mesenchymal stem cells from the walls of your bone marrow cavity. And once I aspirate that, I don't need to centrifuge that. I can inject straight. So I skip the centrifuge. So doing the PRP and mesenchymal stem cells, things to avoid are leaving. Steroids and non-anti-inflammatory medications inhibit the wound healing. When you do the platelet-rich plasma injection or the stem cell based therapy, the first thing happens is generation of inflammation. Any wound healing, when you have injury or something, the way it heals, its first response is inflammation. body always gets inflammation first. If you have a cut on your skin, the first thing you see is all this red. That's inflammation. It must. So if you continue taking the non-anti-inflammatory medication or steroids, it's going to inhibit and it's going to interfere with the function of the platelet-rich plasma and the stem cells. Local anesthetic, in contrast, may be cytotoxic. Platelet-rich plasma is okay to inject with the local anesthetic or the contrast dye if you use, but the stem cells you cannot mix with local anesthetic or contrast because it's a cytotoxic, it can kill the stem cells. So it depends upon which structure we inject and what we're injecting, we decide whether contrast necessary or not. Usually we don't mix the local anesthetic contrast with the platelet-rich plasma anyway. The local anesthetic to numb up the skin and numb up the tissue before the injection is okay. So I'm not torturing you guys. You can still numb up. You cannot just mix it. Or if you're injecting in the knee joint or if you're injecting the disc, in the lumbar disc, usually, we put the contrast, make sure we are there. That you cannot do when you're injecting the stem cell in the disc because it can destroy the stem cells. What are the contraindications? Cancer, anticoagulants, if you're on a blood thinner, depending upon where we are injecting, you may or may not have to stop the blood thinners. It's like if you're injecting in the lumbar disc, you have to stop the blood thinner. If you're injecting like joints, you may not have to stop the blood thinner, you can still do the injection. If you have any infection locally where we're doing injection, a systemic infection like your UTI, pneumonia, sinus infections, you have to wait until infection is cleared. Severe osteoporosis, just you have to be careful. If you have severe osteoporosis, when we put the needle in the bone, it can crack the bone. You have to be very careful. And too severe pathology in areas of targeted routine. Too severe pathology means someone has bone and the joints. They have severe osteoarthritis, no cartilage left, no tissues left. The stem cell of PRP doesn't work. But there's nothing to regenerate. We need something. It's called regenerate. It's not generation, it's regeneration. Something has to be there to be generated. So if there's nothing there, it's not going to work. So quick injection protocols, again, NSAIDs and steroids have negative effects on platelet functions, may decrease the growth factor release from the platelets, as well as it can suppress inflammation and doesn't help with the healing. Most authors or most people recommend stopping NSAIDs and steroids 7 to 14 days before and 2 weeks post-injection. Sometimes before the injection, 7 days is okay. Someone cannot stop for 14 days. Sometimes some people have like rheumatoid arthritis or some other, but you have your NSAIDs. We try to stop for 7 days instead of 14, that's fine. But post-injection, 2 weeks, usually must. What do you expect after the injection? It is normal to feel very sore for up to 2 weeks after stem cell therapy or platelet-rich plasma. Again, because of the inflammation generation. So far I have done these injections, I would say probably one or two patients have increased pain, other people have some soreness for a couple of days, and they all went through it. For the first 48 hours, you should rest the area and use as tolerated. So you just have to take it easy for the first 2 days to week. Even though you may not have increased pain, you should just rest that area, not just, you know, to overdo the stuff. And it's not because it's gonna injure the platelets or the stem cells, it's just because you're gonna have more pain, more inflammation. It's already inflammation generating there. For the next 2 weeks, you do perform light stretching, range of motion exercise, so all like post-injections. 2 weeks after the injection, you should be, you know, start with the strengthening exercises and other physical therapy if you're doing or home exercise. You can slowly, progressively start, you know, increasing your exercises. It takes about 8 to 12 weeks for maximum results. Remember, this is the regeneration, very slow process. It's like healing process, like when the wound heals slowly, the same way, it's gonna take time to heal. You're not gonna have the effect like you get with the cortisone, your steroid injection, like it starts working 1 to 3 days, within 7 days you get maximum response. That's not gonna happen with this. you have to have patience with it. So normally I have seen how it does, as if you do the injection, you may or may not have increased pain for about a week, 2 weeks. If you have increased pain, at 2 weeks it comes down to baseline, your pain. And then it slowly gets better. After 4 weeks or 6 weeks, you may feel there's no improvement, but there is regeneration going on. After 7-8 weeks, you really feel that it's better. And the way people realize that they are better, they're like, they did the activities that they were not able to do before because of the pain. Suddenly they realize, oh wow, I did all those things and I had no pain. So that's how it works. It's like not instant. Stem cell therapy is usually combined with the PRP injection, so we usually inject both leukapheresis plasma and stem cells. Also depends upon where you inject. And the reason is some leukapheresis plasma creates a sticky fibrous network in the tissue injected. That sticky fibrous network helps stem cells to kind of stick in that area, so they survive for a while. Now the stem cells does not stay in the injected area for a long time. They usually die within a few days to weeks, but they already have started the cascade of the healing, we call it. So they brought lots of growth factors and started to form new blood vessels and all those things. There's something called stem cell farming. That's the concept, or that's how it works. The stem cells are the seeds. Leukapheresis plasma and the growth factors into that are the fertilizer, along with the stem cells. The surrounding tissue is the soil. The vascular supply is the rain or moisture. And regeneration healing is the desired crop. So if you have soil there, and then you put the stem cells and leukapheresis plasma as the seeds and fertilizers, it basically grows your crop. Remember, as I said, leukapheresis plasma as well as stem cells also helps to create new blood vessels and bring the more blood. And when the more blood comes, more growth factor comes, more stem cells comes in that tissues to heal it. More macrophages, one kind of white blood cells, they come. When they come, basically what they do is they eat the dead tissues. So they get rid of the dead tissues and the stem cells now form in the growth factors that regenerates the new tissue. Without seed, fertilizer, moisture, or good soil, there is likely to be no problem. And this is the reason when I say the surrounding tissue is the soil. That's why if your pathology is too severe, there is nothing there, you cannot grow anything. What kind of conditions we use this kind of treatment is called biologics. Osteoarthritis of the joints, tendinopathies, acute sport injuries, sacroiliac joint pain, degenerative disc bulging, herniated disc, facet joint pains, carpal tunnel, piriformis syndrome. Besides, I put some pictures like we can inject in the shoulder joint or shoulder joint arthritis, rotator cuff. You have impingement or your shoulder muscles or tendons have been torn or has been inflamed for a long time. Tennis elbow, lateral tendonitis, the elbow pain outside, inside. These are our tendon related problems. Hip tendons, the greater to bursa, that's commonly we say hip bursitis, greater to bursa. Hip joint injection itself. Again, bursa or tendons. We can inject in the Achilles tendon if someone has a tendon problem. Plantar fascia, you can inject. People have plantar fasciitis, you can inject that. Knee joint. Again, plantar fascia or some of the foot and ankle joints. Obviously, the low back. So we can inject for the herniated disc. PRP also has been used for other treatments besides musculoskeletal, common, something called vampire facelift. PRP is also used in aesthetics, something called PRP micro needling of the face to improve the quality of your skin on the face to look more younger. Currently in the dermatology, they use for the hair growth and some skin rejuvenation to get rid of the acne scars, some wounds, all those things. hair restorations. So you can fertilize your lawn. How dare you tell me you found a hair in the soup and on the ball. It has been used for the sexual health too, with the lots of other problems. Wound healing, they're injecting clitoris plasma and stem cells in the people who does not, their wound doesn't heal, you know, like sacral decubitus, like someone is in a sitting stand or lying down for a while and they develop the wound and not healing well. Someone has diabetic ulcers and some other disorder that causes the wound that doesn't heal in a normal. So they inject those things and it's like charming. Obviously, I cannot heal that. So, lots of people using these treatments, many of the celebrities, so we can go through a couple of. This is a vampire facelift. So one thing to remember is this is regeneration, means you have the tissue damage, we did the injection, we regenerate the tissues. Is that permanent? No. Because your body always regenerates. So once you regenerate the tissue, you have to maintain it. You have to take care of it if you want to keep it the same way. If you don't do physical therapy, home exercise that's needed to be done lifelong, whatever the regeneration happens, it's gonna degenerate. So you have to be careful, you know, you have to think about that. This is not permanent, like it's not something like augmentation or something that, hey, it's gonna stay there for a while, forever, you know.
In general, how long will it last?
The platelet-rich plasma can last up to 2 years or longer. Injection-wise, sometimes you just need one injection, sometimes you need 2 to 3 injections. And the way we decide is, as I say, it takes about 8 to 12 weeks to get a complete response. So I would wait about 12 weeks, 3 months, 4 months, and then decide whether you need the second injection or not. Stem cell-based therapy usually lasts much longer. It works better. In my previous presentations, I said this and they liked it. Like, platelet-rich plasma is like buying Kia. And the stem cell is like buying Lamborghini. Yeah. Price wise is the same. Yeah.
If you have, I know you said it's illegal to use embryonic stem cells, but if you have your own from a birth, can you use those? Like we have our own sort of facility.
Right, but that's not embryonic, that's your own.
So it's not either from my son when he was born. Yes.
Right, so that's the platelet. Okay. That's the placental blood.
Okay.
That's whole different.
That is sort of
right. Embryonic is when they, you know, when the embryo is like 4 weeks, 6 weeks old.
Oh, okay.
And they take it out. That's
okay.
Yes, you can use. They have the tissues from placenta. They can do placental tissues. They have amniotic fluid tissues. That's available commercially. That you can inject anywhere.
Okay.
One thing to remember: those things does not have stem cells.
Okay.
And the only thing they have is a. Lots of growth factors and cytokines like platelet-rich plasma, almost platelet-rich plasma, but it's a little bit more concentration, but there's no stem cells and those things.
Okay. And then the other question was the cervical spine. I know you showed you do the lumbar spine, but do you also specialize in the cervical spine?
Yes.
Since this is from the person's own self, and different people say, oh, it worked great, and others do, but not knowing what technique and how they were used, is it possible that the body's own alterations over time is not acting? I mean, is it the stem cell you're using the same as what you're injecting into, or is there factors that could change so that really it doesn't mesh 100%?
I mean, no help 100%? I don't understand.
Well, yeah, I'm trying to. You've got the stem cell, or and or the plasma, like rich plasma, and you're injecting it into something, but for some reason that person's body is not really totally compatible with itself. Has that ever been an issue?
Injecting yours?
Right.
No. You mean the rejection or the reaction?
Or some sort of not as good a reaction because of some sort of alteration.
Because it's your own stem cell, own tissue, so you're not going to have any rejection or reaction.
Okay, so there won't be any alteration in the adult cells compared to... Okay.
Even though the placental and amniotic fluids coming from other person, there are no reports of rejection or the reaction too, because it's treated the UV lights and all those things.
Universal.
Medical insurance cover any of this?
No.
I know the answer.
Is it considered experimental still, or is
yes.
it?
Yeah.
In line with that last question, do you anticipate any time range where the United States will finally get in line and be able to recognize this, and insurance may cover at least some of it someday? How long?
We have no indication. We're trying. I would say so far we were successful to one of the workers come to cover it. Very rare, but we got it. But no other insurance is covering at this point. Anytime we do the platelet-rich plasma injection, we need the temporary code to the Medicare. So I guess Medicare or CMS is collecting data. I don't know about what they're going to do with that data. It's like they're looking into it and trying to cover it. But it's making a big wave in the United States. Even recently in the Senate, they passed the bill to expedite. And I talk about the musculoskeletal, but the stem cell-based therapy has been used in many centers in the research and everything for the systemic disease, cystic fibrosis, cancers, the emphysema, MS, neuropathy, those requires IV injections. Your domestic cannot do the local injection, the IV injection of the stem cells. To do the IV injection, you have to get from the adipose tissue and you have to have the stromal vascular fracture. And that's only happening at the research center under the research, because in the under the research is allowed to do that. But I cannot do it in my facility. So military also growing nose and ears from the stem cells.
Mm-hmm.
So it is like it's really changing the how it's working. And as I say, so if you go to Europe and everywhere, it's much advanced and they treat lots of things. United States is always the last one.
Yeah. So where's the research facility? Where are they happening, in numerous places, or is it?
Yeah, if you go online in research, they have some centers. They have like different centers. They do the research. Particularly the big ones like California, New York, all those things. They usually enroll in the research. That has been going on. They haven't tried for the heart diseases, lung diseases, MS, neuropathy, Alzheimer's disease. They are trying. Parkinson's.
What would be the cost of an average stem cell treatment?
Stem cells can range from, in our facility, from $4,000 to $12,000.
What about if you need more? What if you have to do
That's negotiable. I think we are the cheapest in the country.
The most economical.
Right. You can ask Dr. Kapinger, he's from the south, and there's a joint injection there costs $8,000 to $9,000 and $1,000 joint.
Can you mention neuropathy? Now is this actually being directly applied to a nerve pathway or something?
No, it's IV.
So it's generalized, it isn't correct. Like you're finding a certain nerve.
No. The only time you can do the local injection is like joints, disc. SI joints, SI joint tendons.
So when you do an IV, then the cell's got to find where it's got to go?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay. Makes sense.
Once you inject, the cell's going to see where it's needed, where the assault is happening.
Okay.
They will just go there.
Okay. Great. pretty smart set.
So for New Yorkers, if you were to do it, say, in the R, it goes to the seat, that's where your problem is?
Yeah. They're trying to do something, tag them in something and injecting the cancers to get rid of the cancers, you know? Like if you have a tumor. But I think it's still there, it's an experimental level.
The harvesting process, how long does that normally take?
5 minutes.
What's the quantity that you check?
How much the quantity? It depends how much I have to inject. So if I have to inject in less than the knee joint, we inject 5 cc, so you take out 5 cc. We inject in back of knee joints.
The 5 cc, is that before or after the separation?
As I say, I don't do the separation. Oh, okay. I have the special needle. Otherwise, they will take out 60 cc. And then they have to centrifuge to get the 5 cc out of them. Same thing with the platelet plasma, obviously we centrifuge, so same thing. For platelet plasma, we draw your 50 cc blood. Then we do the two spins to get 3 to 5 cc out of them. Starting, if you guys have any questions, any enrollments, if you have questions later, feel free to call us and we'll respond to you. We also have, I think, programs like if you want to do the pre-evaluations, you can come and see me as a pre-evaluation in my clinic and talk more. So feel free to do that.
To see if you're a candidate for it?
Yes. I mean, can I see like more detail of, hey, I have this problem, am I candidate or not? Depends upon what kind of studies you have. I may not repeat the studies, like X-rays, MRI, something you see.
So would those studies, additional studies that you might have to do, be in, a cost additionally to the
four? That's covered by insurance. Because many times, many structures, if I have to inject, I may do the diagnostic block, making sure that's causing your pain. That's covered by insurance. Like, for example, if you have a sacroiliac joint pain and you want to do that, I would first do the diagnostic treatment injection, making sure it's definitely that. That's covered by insurance, no insurance.
Okay. If I'm bringing the MRI, you alluded to a problem with the MRI. You determine which route I should go.
Correct.
If you have the degenerative disease in your lower back, and it's several areas, do you do one area or all of them?
We can go up to 2 to 4 levels. If we're talking about the disc joints, mm-hmm. We can go 2 to 4. Probably max you can do 4. If it's a disc issue, probably 2. Any injection in the disc could be the more painful for a couple of days.
Join the club.
That helps.
And let me see your spinal stenosis, if that doesn't work for you.
Neither kind of injection works for your pain.
Spinal stenosis is basically bone formation, mm-hmm. extra calcium formation that's causing narrowing of the canal. Yeah. It's like mechanical, there's nothing to degenerate or take away. There are no data yet, or nobody has shown that if you inject the base plasma stem cell epidural, like a new injection, mm-hmm. does it work or if it doesn't work, we have no data. They are also concerned that if you inject the epidural space, and if they form the more bone,
right.
If the stem cell gets stuck with the bony tissues, you get more bones.
Right. Yep. You can access the MRI test in the SRS from the SRI.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That's why I say if you come for the evaluation, I have to look at X-ray, MRI, see what's causing your pain, and I tell you whether can you do it or not can you do it. But hey, I need to do the one diagnostic log, making sure. before I take your money.
Lots and lots of it?
Yep. Yes?
You have other treatments, though, of course, for back problems, not just the stem cells or the blood plasma, right? Like shots, et cetera, et cetera.
Yes. Your whole range.
Yeah.
You do surgery, too? I mean...
Dr. Duke Mason.
Where?
The neurospine surgeon.
Oh, okay.
He does the spine surgery. He's our neurospine surgeon. In fact, today he did 5 levels fusion in our surgery center. Outpatient.
And how do they do after that?
We keep them here 4-6 hours and they go home with the nursing 24 hours.
I'm one of his patients.
Did it work?
Oh, yeah. I had laser surgery on my neck when it was experimental, so, yeah.
If you go to hospital, you have to stay overnight or two nights, 3 nights. People go home. He does here. You go home within 4 or 5 hours. If you go to the Facebook or the Duke's Fine, we actually have the videos where patients have fusions done. And the patient is dancing after 4 hours.
Wow. I haven't danced in a long time.
Come up dancing.
Yes.
In the packets that you have, it's a lot more information and as well as a bio for Dr. Patel with a lot of the procedures and injections that he does in addition to the ones that he spoke about today, as well as the surgery that Dr. Duke does as well. So it's a lot of information in those packets. If anyone would like to schedule an appointment with Dr. Patel, sign up to get more information, like he mentioned, a consultation visit as well, we have our schedulers on hand to do so for you. All right, if there's not any more questions, thank you all for joining us this evening.
Thank you. Thank you. Dr. Duke, I'm sure I have any evaluations or free MRI.